obviously what we build as the big game of the weekend was Wales South Africa, which I suppose we could segue into now, because that was also a tremendous game, and fair dues to Wales. We didn't call it. We were actually sitting on the fence and couldn't really like decide what we were thinking.
What I had said was that I also acknowledge that I could easily be naive on this just from not watching enough of Wales as a national team and sort of just drawing parallels between Wales and Scarlets and leaving.
They're different entities.
They are
now.
Truly, and but in what I had said is that matchup player for player, I thought that the Springboks were stronger. I thought that they were going to find the killer plays, and I thought, you know, Wales were going to have to score tries to win, but. To be fair to Wales, like in another day, they may not even have had to. And a big factor in that 6-9 win over Australia, you have to think, is the defence, which is which was incredible. And that was the big factor that we didn't. As much as I was saying, Springboks have a better team. Wales have the intangibles. Springboks tired. There were some tangibles like defence, and it was especially that second half. It was super impressive.
Oh yeah,
they'd like the Springboks. Like we watched them against Scotland, we watched them against England. The degree to which they just physically dominated those teams, like every contact against England and Twickenham, I know they lost the match, but it was in terms of the balance of play, it was all Springboks. They were butchering things in the 22, but every carry against big English forwards, they were just going through them like shit through a goose. And then they did the same thing against Scotland. It was a wake up call for Scotland and Murrayfield just being dominated to that extent. And obviously they muddled up a bit and nearly ended up making it a very close game, as they did in Twickenham. But that was not the tale of this loss. They were not able to get over the game line. They were shocked. Wales is tackling, and their simple blitz defensive system is phenomenal. They don't let up.
I think what we did, you definitely saw a South Africa that were a little blunted from the help. Like they weren't playing at their right pace, and they were a little bit just predictable in terms of where the ball was going. It was the same kind of plays coming from the same playmakers. You're drawing a point. They probably do need Faf currently for their system entirely. And yet it was still a close game. But I thought Wales could have actually won by more. Like even especially those first 20 minutes, man, that was like, I was watching and I was going like, this is how this game's gonna go. Because South Africa looked like that. Even towards the very beginning, they had a play where they went from right to left and then quickly kind of toe poked it through. And you were making points like, I suppose it's a fine play. It's all right, like as a play. It's not bad. Now
that was Jesse Creel's little kick through.
But it's like, it's not the play of a team that are coming here to try and throw the ball around and score a load of tries and put Wales to the sword. That was not the buzz at all. Wales were chopping them down and kind of sending their attack into reverse a little bit before they'd end up aimlessly kicking it. They did a very good job actually of exposing their wingers in terms of Wales' ball in hand. They did a really good job, because like the wingers are new this year, have been stellar, and have not really been challenged in that way, and yet it is a tendency. And we notice in the Northern Hemisphere it tends to be less of a trait than in the Southern Hemisphere, just in terms of how wingers act on defence.
This is specifically about the rush, is it?
Yeah. Like I think Wales just caught the inward shot, like just managed to get on the outside of the outside man by duping them in and
especially
just getting them caught
for that second try immediately off first phase. It's what the Springboks have been doing this year. It was a great job at shutting down the All Blacks, but there were hints of it with Finn Russell last week with Scotland that you know, if you do push up and you are against elite players, they are going to find the space that you're leaving outside. And the Springbok defence works best when there are shooters in the wide channels, but everybody inside him is rushing. So it's all about pressure. Pressure, pressure, pressure. You have 2 seconds to make a decision as a 10. Then you can't throw that pass because the winger is there, and then you get mushed. That's what they did to the All Blacks. They just forced them to operate at lightning quick speeds, and the All Blacks often couldn't do it. In general play, their line speed wasn't nearly as tigerish as it was that day.
It wasn't the same. So you can see the symptoms with their ball in hand in that early play, but also off their defence, they were a bit shorn of leadership on that front, and it was just a little bit passive. That much that Wales were getting on the front foot and winning those contacts. Wales were the ones who were there, dogged and determined, and their autumn has been a stellar success, as has their year.
Yeah,
it's kind of been blinded by the Ireland talk, and obviously Ireland have had a great year as well. Ireland, New Zealand, huge game and all this, but Wales seething in the background, because they shouldn't be in the background, have been having an awesome year. And you were right in saying, I have watched a few more. I did watch some of the summer games. This autumn has impressed me a lot, because they've kind of moved away from my take on the Six Nations was that they were implementing some of that Scarlet's structure and trying to sprinkle some of the Scarlet's recent success over the national side.
They were getting
side.
Quick tries.
Yes, yeah. Striking, yes. Which is what you associate with Welsh rugby, which is part of what we made us overly critical of the power-based game they were kind of almost exclusively doing sometimes with ball in hand.
We were appropriately critical of it. It was
Welsh either. Yeah. Like, look, what you associate with Welsh rugby is kind of Scarlet's. That's certainly my take on it is... That kind of sweeping end-to-end stuff where you can just grab a try from speed and accuracy alone, beautiful thing. Yeah. And they've brought that back in, but even things like selecting Lydiate for the Australia game and stuff, Lydiate back into the fold, it was reminding me, Warren Gatland's been there for a long time now, so this is more like a 10-year project. When you're thinking of a coach and his World Cup cycles, it's like a 4-year thing.
Yeah.
But you shouldn't sleep on the fact that Wales have had this system now for... Nearly,
especially in defence, they have down to a
and they know exactly what they're doing, and it means they match up against sides that are like South Africa are still a more physical side than them, I think, and player for player. But that didn't matter because they were a little bit slow and laboured in what they were trying to do. They were leaning a little bit too much on what's worked before, which was some of the big men, and those were the marked men, and Wales were happy.
That was the huge thing.
Yeah,
what Springboks would like to do in an ideal world is get over the gain line. Then we swoop it out. Pollard gets it, swooping past LaRue, space, numbers. Now we're dangerous wingers.
Yeah.
That's how their attack functions. Mm-hmm. The very first part of that, to get over the game line aspect of it. And maybe there's an argument that there isn't enough variation in there. A lot of the time, you know who's carrying it. He has his latchers and he's just...
Particularly in the midfield. Well, this is where it comes off nine a bit more because it's like you need to...
Faf is always a variation because he's always an option.
Yeah, if he's running a little bit and then you can catch Delindy or Creel on a short line, that just keeps the defence a bit more honest than it was over the weekend.
That is something that they do use when Faf is around. Mm. But... on this game, they were quite predictable. They had their big men. They did have their latchers, but Wales' tackling just stopped them dead. Yeah. And at times, like you associate the chop tackle with Wales, at times as well, it was just physically very strong. Yeah. It was like Ireland against the All Blacks.
Alan Wynne actually impressed me a lot in the physical exchanges.
What else is new,
Oh, well, he impressed me a lot, did he?
Yeah.
As ever. He's a phenomenal player. Loved his captaincy as well. I love the way as well, when a fracas breaks out, he's always near the middle of it.
Yeah.
And he's getting some words said that kind of seem to have the effect of throwing the other team on tilt, but also seems to defuse the ref somehow.
Yeah.
I don't know how he manages it. It's an interesting little balance, but he's a great captain.
Yeah.
And he's some player. Like a couple of years ago, it was kind of, it's kind of comes from watching too much Ospreys rugby, which can't be healthy anyway, but it's like we were wondering about Alan Wynne, thinking how much longer he's got. Certainly in this podcast,
having to do a lot of work.
Certainly when you watch
Sergio Parise.
This is it. Yeah, well, it's starting to shift that way in the Ospreys, but it's like in the Wales jersey, that's where he belongs. And it's it's like no one's coming to Cardiff to try and bully us. We're going to chop them all day.
Chop them, but also just win those contacts. Yeah. And then that was massive. That winning of those contacts was huge.
Yeah.
It stopped the Springboks. And then what the Springboks did is try and go wide anyway. And they did use that variation. They got Pollard on the ball, the flash pass out to LaRue. And LaRue was just having to make plays that often weren't on.
Yeah.
He was under a lot of pressure. Wales' defence is really great. It's great in so many ways, but one of the things that they do really well is maintain their width all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even recall a time that you saw even Cheslin, for all of his bounciness, get actually on the outside of them.
No, yeah.
They were forced inside. Or both wingers, Dianchi and Cheslin, were forced inside by the Welsh wingers being outside them. It was a great achievement. Yeah. And then the one or two times that they were on the wide channels, they did have them slightly outflanked.
Mm-hmm.
The only way to get there was with a crazy LaRue pass. And then a lot of them were forward. He has a lot of work to do as a playmaker in that Springbok side.
And it was just a little bit more help as well. It was a bit too telegraphed for my liking and a bit slow. Slightly too pedestrian. Like, there was no rhythm to their attack either, really, a lot of the time. How much of that was stifled by their physicality?
It was a great shutdown from Wales defensively. Like, if you're Sean Edwards, you're just super happy. It's just perfect. Like, for all of the Springboks' success, they have their weaknesses, and Wales exposed what they were doing wrong.
It reminded me a lot of our particular encounter with them in a World Cup in 2011.
Wales is one where they
just kind of made the defense look, or made the offense ball in hand look very static, very pedestrian, predictable at times in terms of where the go forward was coming from, and it wasn't coming from there, and then striking at the same time with a couple of really well taken, very simple looking tries in the end, and it's like depressingly so when you're looking at it from the other end going like, come on. But they're just a ruthless machine. This is it. Like, in the context of the Six Nations next year, it's Wales who I'm fearing, and it's
for sure
it's an unsung thing, because it's like a lot was being made of I think we were reading in an ECNSU article talking about how Ireland and the All Blacks should be a rivalry for years to come and all this. And I'm like, well, that's fanciful thinking and I'd like to hope so. But one rivalry that's very real and doesn't need any bigging up or doesn't need any kind of media hype, because it doesn't get any until it's, the game week, but it's Ireland and Wales. And
it's primarily, like, as opposed to Ireland and England, which always gets linked with all kinds of history, it's a, like, it's a rugby-based rivalry, this one. And it's just... it's between the rugby communities and it's gone on forever, and it's going to be a massive match when it happens.
Yeah.
As far as what Wales did with the ball, they were, and they were looking at, like, because I haven't watched them that much, and I was thinking, like, is this the man Scarlett's? I mean, they had Anscombe at 10,
which he played very well.
It was all very polished and simple. There were there were nice structures in there. There were nice pods of forwards.
I prefer their ball in hand with Liam Williams at fullback.
That was big. That was a big factor.
It was a huge factor in the ball in hand. One thing, he didn't cover the backfield as well as Halfpenny manages to, credit where it's due, because there were a few kind of speculative enough kicks through that did find grass and then touch, and it was like, it was just too long a test level that you're thinking, you shouldn't be, there shouldn't be landing there and that. But with ball in hand, it just changes them a lot and gives space to their men outside.
Like, genuinely, there's a nice balance to that back line. There's a nice rhythm to it. Anscombe obviously had a good day, and it still remains to be seen whether he's going to be the guy they go to. We were picking up Patchell last week.
We were, but it has to be a kind of a form dictates thing as well, because, like, Anscombe has been playing well, be it from fullback or 10, and it's, you want him in your team.
Yeah, for sure. And in terms of their centres, they're really balanced. Hadley Parks and Jay Davis. Jay Davis was great at getting into the space. Hadley Parks had some furious carries.
Yeah.
Definitely got the better of that exchange with Delindy, who left the field early. Such was Hadley Parks' dominance. And Wales, there was just a nice, very simple rhythm to it. They weren't doing anything exceptional. They weren't leaning too much on one thing.
Yeah,
they
or can one go, person. That's one kind person. Of been a change, because they're very proud of their academy now. Like, it was a thing in years gone by under Gatland that the team was kind of set already, and there was obviously there were things like Tipperick's non-inclusion despite form kind of dictating for ages that he should be there, but he wasn't. But now they're getting that balance right between form and play and kind of giving game time to other players. I think they're building very, very nicely and suitably under the radar. They'll enjoy not hogging the spotlight the year out from the World Cup, which is
I like them a lot. I liked the balance of them. I thought they were very good and very good in a lot of areas.
Yeah.
The scrum was solid as well against a tough Springbok scrum. They obviously line out, they can, I mean, going forward it remains to be seen against the top teams how good their line out's gonna be. But obviously Alan Wynne-Jones is an elite operator.
Yeah.
So too Ken Owens. So you have to think there's strength there. Their scrum again is the same, solid. So all over the park. Breakdown Tipperick, one of the best out there.
Yeah.
All over the park.
Yeah, their scrum is another greatly improved aspect, because that was a kind of a chink in the armor in years gone by, and like for even when they were more exclusively a power based game, they didn't quite have the scrum to back it up, which was always like a bit of a thing that's going to stifle you when you're trying to win that way, and it led to a few close, tough losses.
The only way they ever scored a maul try was with 13 men as well.
Oh yeah, and they do like joining the maul.
They do, and like they do now. This team though do have a lot of different ways of scoring, and I'm just very excited about them.
Yeah, they look excellent. Yeah, they really do. They absolutely. They look, and this is it. Like, speaking as a purely from an Irish point of view, if the case is next year, as I suspect it is, that Ireland and Wales are the powerhouses of European rugby, and that it all comes down to Cardiff on the last day, that's a good place to be.
Yeah.
I like that a lot, because there needs to be that kind of balance, and it's like it's just good for the Celtic cousins too.
We'll see if that happens. I mean, there's a lot of
stuff that has to happen. Yeah. And
Wales this year have to go to Murrayfield.
You do,
obviously playing England and Cardiff. It, like that's all to come. From the Springbok perspective, obviously this match is going to leave a little sour taste.
It will. It's a good way to punctuate what has been it's an uppy downy season, but generally up considering where they come from.
Oh, totally.
Like, there have been definite positives. There have been a few little kind of shining errors, a few little glaring weaknesses that need to be addressed now a year out. But they're, like, as far as cleaning house is concerned, which we kind of outlined in podcast gone by, is what one of Razzie's main jobs when he gets in is just kind of clean up shop and get these good players focused, get them defending aggressively, and get them going.
It's definitely a good squad.
Yeah.
On the field, though, there'll be disappointments that certainly their inability to adjust and read the game, like it wasn't working for them to go for a ball. They didn't vary it enough with ball in hand. I know Papi was there instead of Faf, so it was definitely more leaning on Villy and Pollard. And what they ended up opting to do for a lot of the first half was bombs. Like, they went for those overhead bombs the same way they exit, and they don't have an elite fielder of a ball. So Liam Williams had a field day with a few of them, and it generated momentum and chaos ball, which Wales feed off.
Yeah.
And it was a mistake, and it still is a mistake that they opt to. They're just doing it because other maybe just because Ireland do it. They're just doing it because other teams do it. What they need is to do something else with the ball. Wales, as we say, very good defence. Push up really quickly.
Very wide
to the line. Inexperienced, well, not inexperienced, but not ideal cover of the field in Liam Williams.
Mm-hmm. And I think wingers have a similar bad habit of creeping up into it's not even a bad habit in the context of their defence, but there is space for the chip on the top.
There were times watching that game back that Gareth Davis wasn't at all in the backfield, wasn't covering. There was load of space for chips in behind. Somebody needed to make that call, those plays. Mm-hmm. They tried one or two towards the end. They were always frantic and at inopportune moments.
Yeah.
But there were moments to take them on, and they didn't. And those are the kind of heads up plays that really you need. Like, if you want to be winning World Cups, you need to be able to cope with adversity and things not going your way, and you need to be able to produce plays in those moments.
Yeah.
And from a Bok perspective, that simply didn't happen. I mean, they very much just stuck to their rhythms and got nowhere.
It became a bit telegraphed. Yeah. If you're leaning on those two playmakers in the back line, you're kind of spinning it out prematurely anyway. Yeah. They do tend to stand deep, so if they're not getting the go forward in the tight anyway, they're just going to get snagged behind the game line, which, like, Wales shooters knew exactly who to aim for. So it was like, and all day that was true, because there was just no even a few chips over the top, a few short, I don't know, they could have varied it a lot more, but didn't.
I remember, because Sean Edwards, as much as Gatland's attack has changed and personnel have changed, Sean Edwards' defence has stayed quite true.
Quite similar, yeah.
Wales had a great year, I think was one of the years. No, it was 2014, so Ireland won the Six Nations, but Wales were around and they were backing themselves. And it was the same Warren Ball Wales that we know and love.
Mm-hmm.
They were with their usual players, and they went to Springboks on a June tour, went to South Africa rather, and they rushed up the same way, and it was the opening test, and the Boks absolutely stuffed them. And they did it, I remember, just with little dinks. I think it was Pollard and LaRue as well, just little dinks over the top for
was
all.
Was Pollard or was it Stain? Might have been Stain.
Okay, maybe it was. But it was it was constantly just little chips over the top for, I think, LaRue to run onto a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And they just tore them asunder. They really absolutely
exposed that. Yeah.
Exposed it completely and did for them. And for all of Wales, is we have our solid defence. That's always been an area that if you're accurate, you can
the
get
All Blacks
them.
Have shown a few tries that way. Bowden
Barrett
well.
Scored tries like that against them.
It's a good tactic against them, more so than the bomb, because they're well equipped to deal with it. Like, they haven't always been, but like Ireland, remember, did that game that they exposed, that game that Warren really hated in Dublin, where we just kicked everything and anything.
But not into the air.
No, it was like corners. It was finding the space behind their defensive line, because their wingers do roam up to bring that intense line speed and shut off the outside.
The problem for the Springboks, though, in trying to do, look, copying Ireland, it has its merits. Ireland's game plan, especially that particular game plan, was all about the sheer game reading quality of and kicking ability of Murray and Sexton, and not all teams have that.
Indeed, yeah.
Also, copying Ireland in the way that they play Wales is the worst possible context to copy
this
Ireland.
This is true. Kryptonite. Yeah, as a fairly for an Irish game plan is Welsh tackling.
They were naive in doing that.
Yeah.
That said, last test of the year, they did hang in the game. They're not going to be too disappointed by it.
No,
but they didn't properly prepare for it enough. But it's just important that they learn their lessons.
Yeah.
In those early parts of the game, just simple things like getting around the corner, like for that Francis try at the very start. They were like Georgia, like they just weren't getting around the corner quick enough, and they were shipping slight tackles as a result of it. It was good multi-phase from Wales, and it ended up in a deserved try with a good offload, but the tempo was just doing them for defence. They weren't getting around the corner, they weren't slowing the ball up, and they looked very, very weak in that particular play.
I was saying, what was important was Wales were quicker than them throughout as well. Much quick speed of thought and speed of action. And they got around them and just kind of they dictated the pace.
Yeah.
It was great to see, because it was a pretty assured performance from a now mature Welsh team with a lot of balance. It's not overly reliant on its old school leaders. It's managed to, things like Sam Warburton retiring this year is obviously a sad thing, but it's kind of marking an evolution in this Welsh project, that there are now players filling into that model, understanding what he brought them, as far as like he was the model of it in that 2011 World Cup. He was the model that got them training right. He was Warren's man for the example of what the team should be.
Yeah.
And now we've gone through, similar to what we always harp on Ireland and Leinster, through like a gradual series of events and years that stack up together to make learnings. And this Welsh team are now getting to a point where they're properly mature. They know exactly what they're doing.
Yeah.
Good balance all over the park, and players to come in should people fall. Not the most attritional game plan on the, in the world either, so there's not as much fear. Like, I wouldn't be as fearful for Wales as far as injuries are concerned as I would be for Ireland, just purely because of the way they play the game in terms of the World Cup.
They don't have any particular player that they lean on too much. You think Ken Owens and Tipper could be the worst losses.
Maybe.
And Alan Wynn.
Alan Wynn. That's what I'm thinking. It would be a big Alan Wynn-shaped gap in the thing. But no team is without a talisman like that to bring them as far as the World Cup. So, like, I'm excited for Wales' chances, really, now. It's been a great autumn, unbeaten autumn, and, a great scalp to get over the Springboks, who have looked impressive for this year.
It was a cracking game, and well done, Wales. Yeah. Maybe see you around Paddy's Day in Cardiff.
Yeah. That'll be some game. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah.